that for me. But hey, everyone, hit, got it. You're being recorded. So my name is Malcolm Odermatt. I'm the current president of BC Grain Producers. Thank you for joining us for our first webinar series. We know this would be far more entertaining if we could be gathered in person at a catered event, but we are living in some interesting times, so this will have to do. As you know, the BC grain producers are pivoting from small plot research to a more agronomic focused mission. That means that all of the meetings from this webinar series will be recorded, as we just experienced. And we're doing this so we can post them onto our new YouTube page so others will have the opportunity to view them. And perhaps one day when you're bored in a tractor, you will be able to go to that same YouTube page and find something not only entertaining, but informative and local. So in order to make sure that those videos are free from acoustic feedback or you talking to your pet, we ask that you mute yourself when you're not planning to ask a question or contribute to the conversation. The mute button is available to you in the lower left-hand corner of the screen. As you can see, okay. If you suffer from a poor internet connection like myself, it may be wise to shut your video feed down at times in order to conserve your bandwidth for the audio signal. This button is also found in the lower left-hand side of the screen. And we may not be able to give you coffee muffins or, luckily for you, Barry, COVID. So we would still like to show you our appreciation for attending our webinar today. And the way we'll do that is by sending you a short survey at the end of the week. And if you would be so gracious to fill that out, then you will be entered into a draw for a prize. So are there any questions regarding anything I just said?
Can you send me that script for tomorrow?
I could definitely do that. Hopefully you have more people than I do. Anyhow, so we will have two different presenters for this morning's session. The first gentleman we have the pleasure of listening to is none other than Keith Uloth with the Pest Monitoring Project. Keith grew up in the stinky city of Prince George and attended UNBC to achieve a degree in biology. We may get pretty excited about bugs from time to time as producers, but insects are truly one of Keith's passions, and he wants to share some of that passion with you today. So take it away, Keith.
Thanks. Thanks for the introduction from Dinky Prince George to you guys up in the piece. Let's see. Can you guys see my screen?
That we can.
Perfect. So, yes, all right. Let's get to the start. Okay. So we'll discuss the pest monitoring season for 2021 and some of the stuff that we saw from last season. So before I go any further, I just have to thank all the funding partners, the BC grain producers, putting this on and inviting me to give a talk about this and what we saw for the season. Also the Peace Region Forage Seed Association, and then our federal and provincial governments for all the stuff that they do for the project and all the funding. And then IAF, BC's Climate Action and Agriculture, all of them, they also contribute to it. So thank you everybody for funding the project. So it's been a while since I've given a talk at the grain producers, and I'd just like to touch on some of the monitoring that we've increased in the region. So you can see there that we've been doing field peas. We've been doing that for about, I think since 2017, we've been doing field peas. So we did three field peas last year, looking for pea leaf weevil. We did five wheat. We upped our monitoring in the other cereals, so in barley and oats. We've increased that. We've also increased the amount of canola that we monitor. We're up to seven fields this year, and that ranges from all the way into Doe River, all the way up into Presbyteau area. So that's been something that we've kind of expanded, and we're hoping to expand upon some more. You can see some of the cross commodity pests as well, grasshoppers, ligus, aphids, click beetles. We kind of work at that as well, doing some scouting and also some pitfall traps as well. New to 2020 was the horticulture stuff. You can see over here, we partnered with the Northern Cohort in looking at some of the pests that they may have in horticulture. So that was some small market gardens that they were using for their farmers markets, and then also some berries and apples. And one of the big ones in talking to some provincial entomologists was looking for spotted winged Drosophila in the area. And it's safe to say the past two seasons that we've been doing it, we haven't found any, which is good for everyone. And then in apples, we were looking for codling moth, and we actually haven't discovered any of that either. So all good news in the horticulture front so far. And then forage and forage seed stuff, we've also increased some of our monitoring there. But for the sake of this talk, I'm going to just kind of focus on the annual stuff as well. And so this is just a bit of a map to give you an idea of where we currently are monitoring. So you can see all the way down in Chetwynd and all the way up to Prespatu. We kind of have a bit of a roadmap of following the highways, so to speak. And we ventured over into Clayhurst and all the way, we do a bit of monitoring over in Bear Flats as well. So jumping right into the monitoring that we currently do in the canola, diamondback moth. This year, the trap counts were quite low. And so were the scouting and sweeps for larvae. They were also quite low this season, which we kind of expected with that heat dome and diamondback moth being a migratory species. We didn't actually expect to see too many. We put our first traps out at five of the seven sites in the second week of May, and then slowly made our way getting the other ones out. But our first trap detection wasn't until the second week of June. So we had zeros for the first month, which was a good thing for diamondback moths in respect, because they have a 32-day life cycle. And the biggest thing for diamondbacks is that generation count. So I don't know if anybody remembers 2017, we had a really bad year of diamondback moths. And I think quite a few producers got hit pretty hard late in the season. And that was because we had three generations. So this year we had roughly two generations, which was pretty normal. And you can see at this graph over here on the right, this is just kind of gives you a distribution of where we saw our collection of moths. So the yellow one here is Clayhurst. So there was a bit of a majority there. And then the others were kind of evenly distributed through, and then Flat Rock and Tower Lake, it looks like, seemed to be the lower ones. So that was pretty normal. So moving on to the next migratory species. So that's the Bertha armyworm. We don't have a population necessarily in the area permanent. So these guys also get blown in on the winds. And these counts were actually really low this year. We didn't have any more than 10 individuals per trap over the weeks that we were monitoring from the end of June till August. I think we were finished monitoring the third week in August. And at all seven sites, so the numbers were really low. And just to kind of give someone an idea of how low they were, less than 10 individuals. And the threshold for, I guess, when you start to want to be concerned, or they say threshold for uncertainty, is 300 individuals to 900 individuals per trap. So we were significantly low. Moving on to one that was a pest this year, just with the heat and the type of season that we had being hot and dry, Liguus numbers were quite high this year. I think we started reporting on our SMS updates. We were seeing numbers floating around threshold in the middle of July, maybe even early July. And we did note that two of our cooperators that we work with did spray for Liguus as well. And I think some of that just comes down to the fact that canola was $23 per bushel. So that was a significant driving factor as well. I should note that Ag Canada has gone back to the drawing board with Liguus bug. So it currently at $20 per bushel, it's one to two individuals per sweep, but they are tending, I think, to increase that number from two to three individuals right now is what they have, but I think they may even revisit it, even continue to, and have a more solid number, considering the price of canola has jumped up significantly. And their price per bushel only goes up to $20 with their thresholds. So fingers crossed that that changes and they give us something a little more solid for this coming season. So another kind of good news, bad news story was flea beetle. We continue to have them. They're not going to go anywhere. But we didn't see any cotyledon damage, high cotyledon damage this year in the spring or early summer. A lot of it was really less than 25%. And then that we hit that heat dome that came over, and it kind of, it's supposed to suppress a lot of flea beetles, especially the main species we have here, the striped flea beetle. As you can see, that 92% is what we've counted over the entire season. And that seems to be the predominant species here. So I should note, if you look here on the upper right screen, this is kind of from all the trap counts that we did that I've identified and collected this year. 92% is striped flea beetle and about 5% is crucifer, which is fairly normal to the previous seasons that we've been doing this. The big difference between them is that they tend to emerge earlier in the spring. The striped flea beetle does compared to the crucifer, and there's about a 2-week delay between the two. So you'll see your striped flea beetle before and then your crucifer about 2 weeks after. The bad news for producers looking forward into 2022 is that we did see that overwintering generation in late July and early August emerge, and they did some significant damage in some areas, which is uncommon. They usually emerge, they do a little bit of light feeding on some plants, and then they get out of the field and get ready for overwintering. And this year we saw some heavy damage in some serious areas in the south piece and even a bit in the north. And looking forward into 2022, depending on how the winter goes for these guys in their overwintering and how spring is, we could see high flea beetle numbers in the spring. So this is kind of another good news, bad news situation. So wheat midge, the traps overall this season were quite low. You can see up here on the right, our highest counts were in the Montney area, but they were still considered technically fairly low. This may have, again, was probably due to the lack of moisture in the area, in the overall region, and which kind of tends to delay larval development. So the bad news on that part, though, looking forward to 2022, is that wheat midge can stay dormant for 2 years. So if conditions for 2022 are preferable, we may see higher wheat midge numbers in that season, in this coming season. With that being said, though, there is the wheat midge tolerant wheat available. That program that is available has been fairly successful, and I know some of our cooperators use that wheat midge tolerant wheat as well, and it's been it's actually been really effective in controlling some of those numbers, and we've seen some high wheat midge numbers over the past years too. And in doing some of the sampling and getting those graded, we haven't seen wheat midge damage. So it's a pretty prominent, it's a pretty good tool if someone is thinking that they may have wheat midge issues for the coming season. Grasshoppers. So last season, we didn't see any grasshoppers, which was unusual because the rest of the prairies got hit pretty hard. Especially the Alberta piece and even Saskatchewan with that drought conditions that they were having in there, they got hit pretty hard. But we didn't have any really. And our two main species continue to be that Brunner spur-throated grasshopper and the two-striped grasshopper. And they tend to both follow a biannual life cycle. So coming into 2022, we should see high numbers for this coming season. And those numbers could be dependent on how the weather goes for this spring. So if we get a cold, rainy spring, the numbers could be a little lower. But if we get another heat wave, they could go up pretty high. I should note from a researcher's perspective, or from someone who's interested, The Bruner spur-throated follows a biannual life cycle, and that's considered normal. But the two-striped in this region doesn't seem to be following a normal life cycle. They're supposed to be an annual pest. So we've been talking to a researcher in Lethbridge, Dan Johnson, to try and figure out why exactly we are having them both as biannual pests, considering that two-striped grasshopper should be an annual pest. And so we've tried to figure out some of that questions as to why we're seeing this. For anybody who's interested, you can contact me further. So other critters, these are some of the other ones that we monitor. So sweet midge continues not to be in the area. We had three sites out this year and those numbers are zeros. And then pea leaf weevil, that's a new one that we started in 2019 researching. And with the pitfalls, there's been no specimens caught in the BC piece. However, in the Alberta piece, there are some low numbers of pea leaf weevil being caught there. And aphids was another one this year that we noted having seen in cereals. I had a few reports of people having aphid issues, so we went out and checked them out. The two species that we were seeing predominantly were the oak bird cherry and the English grain. And we did see some wheat damage with some aphid feeding and a little bit of spore collection of a disease. I didn't get any results back from the pathologist as to what that disease was, but we did see some damage from aphids this year. Beneficials, ladybugs, we saw lots of them this year, and we saw a lot last year, in the previous season too. We continue to see that seven-spotted lady beetle predominantly, but we also have been seeing some other species like the hieroglyphic and the three-spotted, which is promising. It's really good signs that they are controlling populations that they should. Tachinid flies, that's another one that we've seen over this past few seasons. They continue to be in quite high numbers in late July, early August. Which is a good thing. They tend to feed on caterpillars and a few other little soft-bodied insects as well. So that's a good sign. And then surfeit flies is one that we've also seen some good healthy populations throughout the seasons. And they also are predatory to soft-bodied insects as well. So the big one I think that might make people smile this year who had Liguus issues is this one. We captured a picture of a spider actually eating a Liguus, which was pretty interesting. We have seen some healthy spider numbers too. That's one insect that's not an insect, but it's one that we do keep an eye on as well. And so switching gears, we did some disease surveys this year. Overall, the disease presence was quite low through most of the field crops. Field peas up north, we did do a survey of, I think, five or six fields because there was a fair bit of disease in some of the fields quite north, like in the Prespetu, Buick area. And all the fields that we circled came back with Ascochyta. And then canola, we've been doing a club root survey since 2018 on and off. And this year we switched up the sampling of it. And I think Brenna Shields will talk a little further about it in her talk later this week. But we did some soil sampling in helping, and I think it was pretty good. We sampled a total of 64 fields, and I'll just let Brenna talk about further what the findings were of that. And then cereals, so wheat, barley, and oats. We did some disease surveying in there, and there was quite a low incidence of stripe rust. We did find it in a bit of voluntary wheat, but the biggest diseases that we found was loose smut in barley and in oats. So switching gears again, because the other part of what I do up there is the weather station maintenance. So the BC Peace Weather Agri Network currently has 19 stations active. We have 21 in total. We're hoping to add two more this year. We are also with the grain producers switching gears on their on how they are doing their field work. That their test site, we have taken down the station and are currently looking to move it to Baldonnel, as that's been addressed as one area that has a bit of a gap. So I'll probably be contacting some cooperators or some producers in that area and hoping to put up that weather station sometime in March or April to get it up and online. We've also had some issues with our Kelly Lake station way down south, but we've seemed to have fixed those. It took a while, but I hope we'll have that one up and running for the season as well. The tools currently available for producers in the area continues to be the growing degree day calculator, the fusarium head blight risk calculation, and the wheat midge risk calculation. A new addition, however, is that when you look at your growth charts or your GDD, it will give you a growth stage calculation for canola, wheat, and barley, as you can see here on the bottom of the screen. It's a pretty nice little tool. And in talking to Andy, who does kind of the back end stuff and what I do with the scouting for the pest stuff, they seem to be fairly accurate. We haven't had too many issues with the temperature stuff as we've had in the past. Those issues seem to have been resolved. So I should also note that producers, if you need to go back, there is historical data going back to 2016 for the majority of the sites. And also that historical data includes temperature, precipitation, barometric pressure, and wind and speed direction. So we do have a weather summary coming out. I'm just waiting for some logo approval. And then we should have the weather summary available soon. And it just kind of compares the previous growing seasons so that a producer can get a general idea of how things were from this season or from last season to the previous ones. So you can see here in comparing our Dawson Creek field that we've got labeled the BCGPA compared to the Fort St. John one. They seem to be relatively the same, but in comparing 2020 to 2021, we were quite a bit hotter overall, although the average temperature didn't seem to fluctuate too much, but the overall highs were quite significantly higher in at least June and July. And the other big one to take away from this was also the amount of precipitation. So what we drew from, I think, 7 stations and comparing them to 2020, there is a significant difference. You can see the overall totals comparing them. So Flat Rock had 292 compared to last season, which was 116. So that's quite a bit of difference, even in the amount of millimeters, because that's what it measures in. And then just GDD up here on the top right, just comparing the past 3 seasons. So I can't see my 2021 because there's a window of all you guys participating. So I can unfortunately talk about it, but you can see that there is a significant difference in the difference between the previous seasons. So that's my talk. I just have a few notes to kind of touch up on. I'm looking for more individuals if interested to sign up for the weekly SMS updates. That's something that we've offered and we're hoping to increase the capacity for producers. It's something that we think might be pretty valuable. I haven't had any negative feedback about it yet, so I'm hoping that people still like that. We do also offer it through email with Brenna Shields and her agronomy update, and we also do post it a lot on our Facebook page, which is also there for people if they're interested. New to this season is a pest guide for wireworms. That's something that the research that we've been doing with Wim Van Herk has worked towards. So this does include our area as well, it being in the BC Peace Region. So feel free to check that out. We do have some copies available. If anybody's interested, you can get in touch with me or Talon, and we can get a copy to you as well. And then, yeah, the BC Peace Agri Weather Network. Check that out. That's just for more localized weather. And the Prairie Pest Monitoring Network. A lot of the data that I have shown today and collected over the years is going into their modeling and their forecasting. So those forecasts will be available hopefully in March, early April for people to check out. So yeah, and then there's my email and my phone number if anybody has any questions into regards of some of the other stuff that this project does.
Thank you, Keith. So who has a question for Keith?
I have a question. With all this freezing and thawing and snowfall and then ice, how is that going to affect pests that overwinter here?
That's a great question. So it should hopefully affect them negatively. So a lot of the freezing and thawing, a lot of the insects that overwinter, they overwinter in leaf litter. So with this freezing and thawing, you would think that water would penetrate in there and then eventually freeze and maybe kill some of it off, kill some of those pest insects off. But it's tough to say. Usually if you have a nice snowpack, it gives a good insulation from the cold. But if we don't have that necessarily and we get, say, a nice cold here, a cold snap in the next week or two, that may kill off some more as well.
I got a question too, Keith. On the economic threshold for Liger's bug last year with over $20 a bushel canola, it was quite low. And it was a debate whether to spray or not, like for every year. And I spoke to another producer and they split a field, half sprayed and half didn't. And they saw a 6 bushel increase where they sprayed. We need that data to back that up.
Yeah. Yeah. Sorry, continue.
It's just like you looked at some of our fields last year and we were right at economic threshold and we sprayed some and left some and we don't really have the yield data to back a benefit to spraying because of variety differences. But it would be nice if we had some more work on actually what we do lose in these years with Lycopus bug. That's what we need to know, right?
Yeah. Yeah, and so... I mean, there's a researcher, Hector Carcamo, out of, I think he's in Lethbridge. With the Liger's bug being so bad this year, they kind of went back to the whole drawing table of the threshold and everything because they weren't, he didn't sound totally convinced that the threshold being where it was as effective for spraying. So I think they're going kind of back to the whole drawing table to kind of reevaluate the whole process of it and see if the Liger's bug, if there could be more Liger's in the field essentially, and it might not be as impactful on canola because if you're spraying, you're having negative impact as well. And it also comes out of your pocket. So I think they're trying to reevaluate it. They didn't give a great answer in October about this new threshold that they have. And I think he was trying to reevaluate some of the data that he had to try and get a better idea moving forward. And the other part is that the threshold that I had currently was only up to $20 a bushel. So with canola being $23, it kind of was a bit of a guessing game at that point. So I think they're trying to reevaluate it and go even higher and get a better idea because with these heat extremes that we may be having or weather extremes, we may see some pest populations doing this and having more impact on our crops. Yeah, I don't know if that answers your question, but.
Well, it does. It's just that decision to spray an insecticide is a really tough one to make. The economics say you should spray, but we know that's not beneficial on all the insects. And we sprayed, we panicked and sprayed some, and then we started monitoring and the numbers weren't climbing, so we didn't spray more. And you always want to know if it's the right decision.
Yeah, yeah, I understand. And I mean, when we were looking in your field, that was it too. It was kind of like, you were kind of at that point where do I or don't I? And it's, I mean, for me, I can't tell you because I'm contractually obligated not to. I can just give you the information. but I do understand like where you're coming from, and it is an issue. And I think there's lots of producers in your same spot as of last year that were just like, do or I don't I? And they wanted a better concrete answer. And unfortunately, I think Ag Canada was like, we can't give you a better answer. And I think that's why they've gone back to reevaluating the threshold for it completely. They've kind of scrapped it, it seems like, and are reevaluating it at now. And I think they're probably going to do in the next few years, probably put more money into researching Lygus again, just because it seems like a pest that with these extremes of weather could be one that would cause a lot of damage.
So what you're saying is nobody really knows, and it's a kind of a, I don't know, crapshoot whether you gain or you don't, right? So it's great. You tell me what to do.
Yeah, well, and that's it. I mean, until someone who's more qualified than I am tells me kind of like, this is the definitive numbers that we think should be, I can't give you a solid answer on it, because it seems like they don't have a solid answer for me or for you, unfortunately.
Huh. And there we are thinking you were the guy.
No, someone way more qualified than me works on that side. I'm just kind of the middleman. I know also that they've been reevaluating the flea beetle damage as well, because they've noticed that threshold is at 25% of the cotyledon, but sometimes it can get a little higher and it helps the plant be stressed and grow a little faster. But that all depends on weather conditions and growth conditions as well. So they've started to reevaluate a lot of the thresholds, especially with the influence of climate change.
Well, and commodity prices going up as well.
Yeah, well, and that's it, demand as well. So they're trying to help producers as much as possible, but I don't know. There's always a time lag for that too. And they get funding for research parts, and then the following year it'll be, so Lygus would be the example. We had a bad year of Lygus, they'll get funding for a lot of Lygus research, and then this year will be, you know, unfavorable for Lygus development. And then, so it'll take 2 or 3 years of them to try and get research together when conditions aren't ideal for Lygus, unfortunately. It seems to be the way.
Yeah, those decisions about spraying, Keith, they are the couple of the toughest we make on the farm in the growing season, just about Lygus and flea beetles. Like, and we've had problems, you know. Jennifer's told me, you need to look at a field. Yeah, mm-hmm. I'll get to it tomorrow. Well, tomorrow's too late. The field's already gone, right?
So. Yeah. Yeah. Well, and that was it. It's a hard one to try, and especially when you're sitting around that threshold, it's kind of, you want a definitive answer. And I don't know if they're going to be able to give you one right away, but hopefully the Lygus aren't bad next year, and then maybe they can get a better idea. Unfortunately, sometimes Mother Nature doesn't work for us. She works against us in some ways.
Exactly.
So Keith, you talked about both striped and cruciform flea beetles making up the majority of our flea beetle populations, but in that little pie graph, you also had two more species that made up the rest. What are those two species, and are they, their numbers growing in the region?
So one of them is Crepidoptera nana. It's not technically considered a pest species of canola. We find it in canola. It usually is more forestry related, but I know over the years, especially up here in the BC piece, that's one that we find in the canola. And then the other is that other small piece of the pie. It was about 1%. It was just classified as other species, but I know that one is called Apthonia flava, and that is a forestry related flea beetle. So we kind of see it in the trees and kind of in the secondary growth around fields. And I should also note that the flea beetle monitoring that we do, we used to do our trap collections used to be 5 stickies out in a field for the first half of the growing season. And then around late June, early July, we would go down to one trap. We've kind of kept them at five for the past 2 or 3 years now, just to kind of get a better idea of those emerging numbers for the overwintering populations.
Thank you, Keith. Do we have any other questions?
Keith, could you go back to the chart that you had about the precipitation across the region?
Sure.
So down in the Tower Lake area, it says for August, it says that we got 1 millimeter. Is it millimeter?
Yeah, it said you had 1 millimeter in August of last year.
So in like the accuracy of that is pretty good. I just we got substantially less rain than pretty much every area but Dawson Creek.
Yeah, well, and I remember that year, and I know Talon and I looked at that and I kind of questioned it, but I also do remember monitoring your fields and watching storms roll by on the other side of the highway and on the other side of your fields, but not where your weather station is necessarily.
We always say that our neighbors are always getting more rain.
So I think that's part of it, is like the localized weather is helpful, but also like if your weather station is not in the specific spot where the rain is, because it is very localized, like the weather patterns. And you do see it I did see it last year in 2020, I would see a storm and I'd be like, oh, that's gonna hit me while I'm monitoring your field. And it would just blow by and it would be on the other side of the highway. And I'd be like, oh, that's really weird. So it is fairly accurate.
That's the river influence between because of the piece of the Kiskatna, we see the weather get diverted around them two river valleys a lot.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think, I don't know if that would mean that we would have to essentially either move a weather station or maybe add something to another weather station on the other side of the highway, or who knows, but that comes down to budget and some other numbers as well. So, but yeah, I did notice that as well. And there is, if anybody does go on to look at Doe River, they may notice that the growing degree days are slightly lower for 2020. And that's because we had it was a bug in the system, but it was recording in July that the lowest temperatures were minus 32. So that really screws up GDD and all that stuff. So we've had a few hiccups and we're trying to fix them. But again, if you do go on the website and you do notice something that's a bit odd or an anomaly, feel free to contact me and I will try and figure it out, because we do have another server that this data gets pulled from onto the website and we compare the two, because sometimes there's a bit of a hiccup there as well.
So how accurate are these growing degree days? Because like for Prespitu, we're the same as Prespitu for 2019.
Mm-hmm.
And Farmington, yeah, anyhow.
Sorry, I'm going to try and minimize this. So Farmington, I mean, in 2020, Farmington probably would have been around there, just with the amount of precipitation that they got in that area too. It was really quite high. I noticed from monitoring in that area that it was really wet. There was lots of slug issues in 2020. And then comparatively to this year, these numbers in 2021 in this area, like the Farmington Tower Lake area, they might have been a little higher, I would suspect. But again, Prespitu did see the canola that I did see up there was, I'd have to say it was probably some of the best canola I saw this year. And that it probably was pretty, that would probably be pretty accurate, the growing degree days up there, at least.
For that year.
Yeah, for that year.
Okay. It's very interesting.
Yeah, the summary that we've put out is kind of, it just does a bit of this comparison from year to year, And it's kind of, we're hoping that we can try and get a better idea of some of the patterns that we're going to see. But I mean, in doing that summary, we can only do so much with it and show it to people. But yeah, it's definitely some interesting stuff that we're going to see, that we've been seeing.
And when is that available? You said you're just working out some advertising or?
Yeah, so I've had to, so whenever I do the summaries, because we have a pest summary for the growing season, we have a weather summary, and then I'll probably be putting out a horticulture summary too for what we find in there. And a lot of it is it takes the logos and the sponsoring, the acknowledgements at the bottom. They're always very picky about it has to be 2.5 millimeters rather than 2.45 millimeters. And so they always make me do a little adjustments for it. So I'm just waiting to hear back from them on that.
Okay. Where is the funding for the horticulture monitoring coming from?
So that horticulture funding comes from, it is coming from the climate agriculture. Sorry, I got to minimize you guys again. So Climate and Agriculture Initiative, BC, they kicked in some money for to that group, so to the Northern Cohort, but they also allowed me to increase monitoring into the other cereals. So increasing into barley and oats as well. And then some of the surveying, the disease surveying stuff we do.
Okay.
Okay, well, those are some great questions. Thanks, everyone, and thank you, Keith. So now we'll be moving on to our second presentator for today, which is Glenn MacLean. He grew up on a farm in the South Peace and has worked for the Business Risk Management Branch of Agriculture for 11 years. He'll be giving us an update on crop insurance, and you have the floor, Glenn.
Good morning. Thanks, Malcolm. So I've been trying to, I've been getting quite a few questions here. Guys are trying to budget and make seeding plans, so finding out if they're going to have some insurance that's worthwhile or not, and numbers are still a little bit up in the air here, but I did manage to scrounge a few out that I can probably give you. Just we'll give you a unwritten in stone guideline, I suppose. Insurable values for each crop, I think, are the most critical that you guys need to know. Barley is going to be about $6.50 roughly a bushel. Canola's insurable value will be about $17 a bushel. Oats about $5.30. Peas about $11.50. And wheat about $9. I was advised that these aren't final and signed off yet, but James was pretty confident they're going to be very, very close. And premium rates are fairly steady with last year. They're still your basic 3% of coverage. Peas are always a little bit of an anomaly. They're a bit higher, but there's some strange factors in there that James will outline for the advisory meeting here coming up in March. He told me not to bother trying to explain it. So anyway, I don't know. I hope that those help you out a little bit. I know with fertilizer prices and stuff, you guys kind of need to know something if you're going to have a useful product here or not. So, and the only other update I really have was claims for the 2021 season. It was extremely high claim year in the South Peace. Probably the highest since I've been here, I think, because we're about $12.5 million paid out in indemnity on grain, and another $2 million paid out on spot loss hail. So a total of about 14 a little over $14 million. North Peace was much better off with only about $1.1 million paid out. They got a little bit more rain than we did down here for sure. Yeah, and other than that, I would probably just open this up if anybody has any questions. Really, there's not much more to update here. Yeah, so I think that's maybe about it, Malcolm.
Okay, thank you, Glenn. So yeah, open the floor up to questions.
Chris, I have a question for you. I don't expect anything. I'm a little $17 per bushel for my insurable value. It just seems a little low when I can contract today for $18 for fall delivery. Just hoping maybe they can look into that a little further.
I think they're still looking into these somewhat, Malcolm. I don't think anybody really knows what prices are going to do here. It's interesting. I've heard $17 contract price for fall, so I'm hoping that's in the ballpark there. Yeah, it might be a tad low. I don't know what happens. I think if you get these insurable values up into, maybe a more riskier area on our part, then premium rates have to go up with it. So you got to kind of weigh the odds here, I suppose.
We've been contracting some canola at 19, Glenn, for September delivery.
Okay, I haven't heard that high yet, so that's awesome.
Yeah, that's a good price. That's the others look really good. Actually, it's just that canola one at 17. That would, right now, it's the lower end of the scale. And what you have, peas at 11.50 and barley at 6.50 and oats at 5.30. They're all about where it is right now to contract. The only one that's off is the canola. A wheat at $9. Okay. Like, they've already contracted feed wheat at $10. So,
yeah, I don't know, Barry. I'm just hoping we're close. It's a bit of a crapshoot. I think we're kind of in line with Alberta's prices here. Being our grain industry is a little smaller in the province here, we take a lot of information from Alberta and use it here. So,
but does Alberta not have an option for producers to buy up the amount of insurable value so that if the price does increase to a certain threshold, then it'll jump? I heard that.
I believe they do, Malcolm. Yeah, I believe they do. We don't offer that at this point, but.
All I can think is that $12.5 million you paid out in the Southeast, that number would have been a heck of a lot higher if those values were a bit higher, more realistic to what they could have sold that crop for.
Yeah. But then that drives premium rates higher too. So I don't know where the trade-off is here. We're not trying to insure you for a profit, really. We're just trying to insure you to, cover your costs and make sure you're in the game next year.
Well, that's why I think Alberta does it as an option. So if a producer is happy with just locking in a price, that's their premium. And if you do want to try and buy that up, that's your prerogative. Then might be something to look into.
Yeah. I don't know how well that program's taken up. That would be interesting to see. But you're right, they do offer something similar to that. I'm not sure exactly how it works, but is it too pricey to be popular? Maybe it is, I don't know.
And then, sorry, I cut somebody off when I started speaking. Who was that?
I think we have a pretty good program when you look at it compared to the other provinces. We've been doing fairly well under crop insurance. That adjusted insurable value coverage was quite high at payouts in Alberta this year. So I don't know how that's going to affect their premiums. But
Are the premiums finalized too? Like, so you have the insurable values, but are the premiums finalized?
Well, there are both finalized as these insurable values, Jennifer.
Okay.
Yeah, they're very stable. They're almost the same as last year.
Okay.
Just got to find them here again.
So you guys are just trying to find the balance and keeping the insurable value within reason so that the premiums stay down. Is that kind of what you guys are going for? The premiums
stay within reason. Yeah, that's correct.
Okay. I'm sorry, and I missed when you said what the North Peace numbers were. The claims in the North Peace were how much?
They were only like 1.1 million.
Oh, wow. That's substantial.
Yeah, huge difference.
And how does that compare to the previous pay season? Because there would have been
Don't know that. In...
Okay.
Yeah, I didn't track that one. So I just thought this has been the highest claims season since I've been here.
I just remember you guys saying that last year that that was some of the highest that was paid over before. So.
So with those insurable values and your yield history, you could get $500 an acre coverage?
500 an acre for canola?
Yeah. Well, even if you went to oats, you could get $500 an acre, right?
Depending on your
yield. Depending on your yield history.
Yeah, you definitely should.
Because that would be the highest level of coverage that we've probably ever seen.
Yep. Actually, every one of the insurable values are the highest since 2008 when I started tracking them.
Well, that's good because we have the highest input values we've ever seen too.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah, no, I realize that.
How were people's yield history affected by what happened last year by the drought? And I guess
producers, we've got 10 years history on just about everybody now, Jennifer. So it's only impacted very, very slightly, like 10% at the most if you had zero, right? So I think are eroding slightly, obviously, because of a few bad years here. But the coverage is still reasonable, I think, overall.
Because having good insurance coverage this year would be critical, because we're going to have the highest expenses we've ever seen, and the risk there this year is huge, right?
Yeah.
And
that's why I wanted to try to get these numbers out to you a little bit earlier, so that you know you can set your seeding plans around them a little bit, maybe if.
Remember that kind of backfired last year when the prices went up right at seeding. So.
But the risk of contracting grain as well, right? We've got to cover some of that, a little bit of that risk off as well with crop insurance. Not all of it, but some of it.
Is there any uptake to a program similar to Alberta's for price insurance?
I wouldn't
know that. I don't think so. I guess agri stability is your backstop if prices tank here, but...
Yeah.
So those prices from the Fedri, they will be the agri stability prices as well, right?
I think so, Barry. I don't know enough about agri stability to really comment on it. I just know it works, you know, differently than crop insurance, and it covers different areas. But exactly how it works, I'm not.
Because the two programs together.
Yeah.
The two programs work together, crop insurance and agri-stability, and people that were in a claim crop insurance-wise, if they're in agri-stability, those will be the prices going forward. So that makes that look better for them too, right?
I would think they would use these prices. I don't know, unless they'll set a price in the fall. But... I can try to find out for you.
Have we confirmed a date for the advisory committee meeting?
No, I just know it's in March, James said, but I haven't heard anything confirmed yet.
I believe it'll be on the second.
Okay.
Yeah. And then Robert, I see you have your hand up. Is that by mistake or do you have a question?
Asked by an organic producer. I'm thinking what I know of production insurance, it just wouldn't work for them. Is there, because of the value, you know, they're going to produce less but higher value. Is there an alternate program or a program that would work for them?
No, Robert, I think I might know who you're talking about, but I've suggested, I think agri-stability is their best avenue. We just can't set prices for organic products. We don't have enough information. And I know that's where they're lacking, so.
Yeah, from past grain advisory board meetings, I've heard that, yeah, it's just too hush-hush with, you'll hear, oh, they're selling oats for $30, but from who and where to, that's all too quiet and pretty hard to actually lock down a price when no one wants to really say what they're paying, so.
Yeah, they're chasing their own market. And
okay, do we have any other questions for Glenn? Hearing none, sounds like that'll do. So thank you, Glenn, for your presentation and very informative. And yeah, so you can get back to Barry on his question. Yeah. So I believe that's all we have planned for this morning's session. Jennifer, Kristen, is there anything else we want to cover?
I know, just thank you to everybody who attended.
Yes, thank you.
All right, then we'll bring this meeting to adjournment, or it's not a meeting, this presentation, and thank you everyone, and hopefully you'll be able to attend the other webinar sessions in the coming days. And remember that survey, fill it out, it'll be entered for a prize. Thanks, yeah. Everyone.
I'll be sending it out at the end of the week.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.